Just a quick announcement about the project. The project's obviously due next week, and just a few questions that have been coming up have been related to the electronic submission. Many of you have done electronic submissions for other courses that I teach, but for those of you that have not done an electronic submission in Google Docs before, please follow the instructions exactly on the website. Okay? Many people, when they do a Google Docs submission, submit the way they think they should be submitted. Please follow the instructions exactly. If it's not followed that way, then it becomes a real mess for the TAs and myself to deal with those electronic documents. Okay, so please make sure that you simply follow the bullet points instructions on the course website. Any questions about the course project so far? Okay, so today's class we'll be looking at this example. It seems fairly straightforward, but as we work through it today, you'll see there's a lot more to it that uncovers some of the subtleties between cross-current and counter-current systems. So we'll be focusing primarily on that. How many of you have had a chance to do all the steps and figure out the stages on the diagram? Most of you had a chance? Okay. So in some sense, for those of you that have done that, this lecture will be a recap of that part, but there'll be other challenges for you to work on. If you've not yet done that stepping process, there's a chance in today's class as well to just quickly catch up on that. So let's just resume the theory here. The thinking is that we're going to put these stages in countercurrent to each other. What that means is that my feed enters over here on the left and passes stage one and moves across to the right. Inside each one of these boxes is a mixer and a settler, so what leaves from stage one are two streams, R1 and E1. So R1 and E1 leave from that stage and they are in equilibrium. So that's the key insight here, is we're assuming equilibrium between these two streams leaving. And you'll notice that the notation follows that pattern for the second and subsequent stages. E2 will be in equilibrium with R2. So you can make a note there that stage EI and RI are in equilibrium. And the implication of that statement is that those two numbers are connected on a tie line. Okay, so you're going to see by the end of this that there's plenty of lines on this diagram. There's tie lines and there's operating lines, and they all go in different directions. Make sure that you connect the right stream appropriately. So the two streams leaving are in equilibrium, so they're connected on a tie line. We also have an operating line. An operating line essentially is done from a mass balance. So if we look at a mass balance, here we derived this last time, and there's a nice pattern that develops here as well. F minus E1 is equal to P. So the lower stream minus the upper stream is equal to P. Similarly, R1 minus E2 equals P. We can keep going all the way and write out these differences. I intentionally left this last box empty. Let's just work through that, the nth block, the nth stage. How many stages do we need to get the desired separation? Well, the stream leaving right at the end is Rn. That hopefully contains little to no solute. In other words, we want the concentration of A in this stream to be very, very low. Coming in, we've got fresh solvent. So fresh solvent comes in and moves from right to left, and every time that solvent stream is going to get a little bit more solute loaded onto it, so that eventually what's leaving in E1 is a very concentrated solvent rich with species A. Coming into stage N, we also have the prior raffinate stage, so we'll just call that Rn-1 since we don't know what capital N is just yet. And then leaving from that stage, we have always the R and the E streams. So Rn leaves, this stream leaving is En. So Rn and En are also in equilibrium in this particular final stage. So in this example, what we have, let's just put some concrete numbers onto it. We've got feed at 112 kilograms an hour coming in, 25% A. And we did the calculations, we set it up last time, and what we ended up showing is that we do an overall mass balance first. Capital M is equal to S plus F. And the way we find that mass balance is we take a mass balance over a boundary of the entire system. Okay, so capital M is equal to S plus F. And in fact, that same M is also equal to Rn plus E1. Okay, so what we know then as the next step is we're either going to specify Rn, what concentration we would like to see in Rn, or we're going to specify what concentration we would like in our extract. You can do either. Typically, we'll start with Rn, and we'll say, I would like Rn to be a specific number. So in this example, 2.5%. Once I know where Rn is, 2.5% of A, so I've located it in the vertical direction, I also know it must lie along the equilibrium arc if it's leaving in equilibrium. So Rn is uniquely located at that point. I know Rn, I know M. I can keep drawing that straight line out and find E1. I could have done the reverse. I could have specified E1 up at the top, projected down through Rm, through M to find Rn. Okay, so either you specify E1 or Rn, it doesn't matter. So that's a global picture of the system, but we've got no idea what happens inside it just yet, and that's what the next steps do. To find that operating point, capital P, that's located out here, we need two lines to intersect each other. Well, the first line is quite easy. It's given up over here. F minus E1 is equal to P. So that's that first line. The second line passes through S, Rn, and P. How did we get to that derivation? It follows exactly the same pattern. F minus E1 is equal to P. R1 minus E2 is equal to P. Rn minus S is equal to P. Okay, and so Rn and S and P all lie on the same line. And where those two intersect, we locate point P. That's my operating point. And every stage will obey, every deviation will obey that constraint that it passes through point P. Okay, so that's fairly straightforward. The next step is to start stepping down. We're going to start zigzagging down this diagonal set of tie lines, and we're going to keep going, zigzag all the way, till we meet Rn exactly, or we go just past it. Okay, so that's how we find the number of stages. So the first stage, E1, is in equilibrium with R1. We use the tie lines, and here I've chosen to show that in blue. I mentioned earlier that there's going to be a lot of lines in here, so use two colors. I've used red for my operating lines, and I've used blue for my equilibrium lines. So E1 in blue is in equilibrium with R1, and that's found by interpolating between the dashed tie lines. Once I know where R1 is, I can get its concentration. And then I need to find the next point. I keep stepping down. So R1, I know where P is. I can then draw a straight line through R1 and P and locate E2. And this next slide shows that. So there's P. I know where R1 is. I keep projecting out, and I now find E2. Okay, so I now know E2. Once I know E2, I can go locate R2, because E2 and R2 must be in equilibrium, so I change my pen color to blue again, and I interpolate with the dashed tie lines. So then I get R2, and once I get R2, I can go keep repeating that process of stepping through the operating point P. And here I've done it 6 times. I keep zigzagging over and over until I land at Rn or just exceed it. Okay, I found 6 stages. I know that when I've done this, come back to this example a few months later and repeat it, I've found 5 stages. So you may get slightly different answers just depending on how you are working on that diagram. Everyone's got a little bit of a different interpretation there. Okay. Any questions on that process so far? Okay, so that's a review then of that example. Now let's actually get to the engineering and ask some questions. So here's the first question I want you to answer. What is the recovery? Okay, so go ahead, look back at the equation for recovery and find that number. And once you've answered the recovery question, you might want to find the mass flow of E1. Do you have one, Mohammed? Do you have a recovery value? Okay. Have you looked through your notes to find the equation for it? You should. Go for it, please. Do you have a recovery value yet? Anyone got a recovery value yet? So just an indication, drawing these lines to me is really not the most meaningful part of this problem. The most interesting part is the engineering thought, now figuring out recoveries. And we're going to see next, we're going to step it up a little bit and compare it to the alternative approach and see which is better. So I really need you to be working on this one quite seriously. All are given in the prior slide, in the question statements. Okay, so recovery is really what tells you how well you're doing, right? That's like what we've just done is what you give your co-op student to do. What we're doing next is what your engineering thought and analysis is all about. So this is where you have to think with what objective is. When we're figuring out the recovery, we're essentially asking, if I put in this feed with a certain amount of A, how much of that species A is recovered? What's recovered is everything you put in minus what you throw away here in the raffinate. This is not going to be recovered over here, divided by what you started off with. Okay? So we derived that formula earlier. It's in your notes that the recovery then is equal to 1 minus the concentration in your raffinate stream. So how much A is left over in your raffinate times the raffinate flow divided by the concentration of A in your feed times your feed flow. Okay, so we need those four numbers to calculate that. The denominator is easy. We're given those pieces of information. So we're told my feed mass fraction is 25% of A, and the flow rate of F was 112 kilograms an hour. Okay, so XFA was 25% flowing at 112 kilograms per hour. The numerator is also easy to find, at least some of it. The first value is XRNA. What's the concentration of A in the raffinate? Well, that's exactly what we specified. By the sixth stage, coming off there, I find that I meet RN. Okay, I found that, at least on my diagram. You might find that you stepped over it just a little bit. So we had 0.025 XRNA. That's how much A you're throwing out. But what's the flow rate of RN? How can we find flow rate of RN? Yeah, you got the idea? Lever rule, okay. So let's just quickly look at that on the diagram. We've got two numbers. E1 is over there. We've got RN over there. We're trying to find E1 or RN. It doesn't matter which. Once you find one, you can find the other. And then we've got M over there in the middle. Okay, so the lever rule says the mass of E1 over the mass of M is the ratio of which two lengths? The length of Rn times from Rn to E1. Sorry. So E1 is M to Rn. Okay, so the length from M to Rn, and then the denominator length is the one I'd written initially, the length from E1 to Rn. Okay. So on my particular handout, I did it. The length measurements were 44 millimeters and 114 millimeters. It might be different on your particular copy. And then the denominator mass is the mass of S plus F. The mass of F was 112. The mass of the solvent was 28. So the total feed was 140 kilograms. And that gets you your mass of E1. So E1 flow is equal to 54 kilograms per hour. And then Rn is the difference from an overall mass balance, 140 minus 54, so that's 86 kilograms per hour. So we can then finally calculate our recovery number here. Okay, so lever rule to calculate E1. I could have written that lever rule there to calculate Rn directly, right? The lever rule is not unique. So there's several ways of using it. That's one particular instance. All I needed it for, though, was to get the value of Rn of 86 kilograms per hour. And the concentration of A in that stream was 0.025. Okay, so when you calculate that recovery, you get an answer of 92%. Let me, at this moment, go back to the earlier example. We looked at the cross-current version. So I'll just show you here on the slides where what I'm referring to. Okay, so the earlier question is, it's slightly grayed out over here. The earlier question had asked us to calculate the flow and composition of the extract and raffinate using two cross-current stages. And then I'd asked to calculate the overall recovery and the overall concentration of the extract stream. Okay, let me look at those. I'm going to take the screen up and then put this on the blackboard and show you what I'm referring to here. And then we're going to contrast the two systems and figure out which is a preferred approach. So the cross-current approach, we'll use exactly the same system, right? We want to do a fair comparison. Which should I use, the cross-current or the counter-current? You might intuitively suspect from prior courses that counter-current is going to be the preferred approach, but let's really evaluate this fairly critically. Cross-current says that if I take my feed, so it's the same feed of 112 kilograms per hour, I'm going to contact it with a certain amount of solvent, S1. And in the prior classes, we chose 50 kilograms per hour of solvent. And we have two streams leaving, the extract and the raffinate. And what happens is we recognize that with just a single stage of contacting, we don't do such a great job. We showed those numbers last time. So the raffinate leaving here, we'll call this R1 as well. The raffinate leaving and the extract leaving. So the extract hopefully contains a lot of A. And in this particular example, if you go try this out, I recommend that you go replicate these numbers. That's something you can easily do now with the knowledge we have. So E1 is 66.2 kilograms per hour, and R1 is 95.8. Okay, so that balances from a mass balance point of view. What's of interest to us is the concentration. So in the extract stream, we have XE of species A. This is 30%, so 0.3. And in the raffinate, we're losing out. We're throwing some A away, so XR1, species A. We're throwing some away, 9% by mass concentration. Okay, so 9% concentration of A flowing at 95.8 kilograms per hour. So there's some substantial amount of A that's being lost there just if we stop the process at that point. So what we did, we recognized that last time, and we said, well, let's take that on and contact it a second time. So a second mixer settler. And we're going to get a second extract and a second raffinate stream. And hopefully we've done this better. OK, Okay, now the part for you to go try at home is to replicate these numbers, because essentially the second unit is identical process to the first unit on the diagram, except your feed point, your feed isn't 112 now, with this concentration of XFA coming in was 25%. In this second example, your feed is a different flow rate coming in with a different concentration. So you step off at a different point on the diagram. So make sure you can do that for the cross-current system. And we always have, as engineers, the ability to select the solvent flow. And I'm going to, for convenience, simply use the same solvent flow of 50 kilograms per hour. Okay, and if you do that second calculation, I encourage you to go try that at home. So you'll find that X of A, the concentration of A in the extract stream there, is 11%. So that seems a little bit weird. This concentration of A is lower than the prior stream, but that also does make sense, because the second stage just cleans up what the first stage didn't get. So there's not a whole lot that we can do with every subsequent stage. And the flow rate of E2 for yourself to go verify afterwards is 60.2 kilograms per hour. And R2's flow is 85.6. And then the other number that's really of interest to us is XR2A. So how much A is left over in that second stage? Well, this time we're getting it right down to 2.3%. So let me just quickly point out what we've done here. With two stages, the first stage using 50 kilograms an hour, the second stage using 50 kilograms an hour, we've able to get the same concentration in my raffinate as in the prior example. In the prior example, we were aiming for 0.025, which we got with six stages. Here we're using two stages, and I'm able to get essentially the same mass concentration. Okay, let me just recap that. So here with the cross current setup in two stages, I'm getting XRA of 0.023. With the counter current using six stages, I got X of the concentration of A leaving in that raffinate stream of 0.025, roughly the same number. Which system should I then use? Cross current or counter current?
Depends on your costs.
Depends on your costs.
The cross current uses about four times more solvent.
Okay, so Sean's picking up on the fact that here we've got 50 kilograms plus 50 kilograms, so 100 kilograms per hour of solvent required. Here, you'll recall the number was 28 kilograms per hour. So six stages, more utility costs, higher maintenance costs, definitely a greater capital cost. Okay. So let's do a fair side-by-side comparison here quickly. Put some numbers here. While I'm writing that up, I'd like you to calculate the recovery for this cross currents. I gave you the answer there in the slides. So the answer is 93%, but how is that calculated? So prove to yourself that it is in fact 93% while I get this table ready. And if the recovery is something that's dead easy for you to calculate, this one might be a little trickier. I'd like you to calculate the separation factor of A from carrier C. So that steps it up a little bit for those of you that have already got the recovery number. Okay, so let's look at this comparison. Cross currents here in the first column, counter currents in the second column. How did I get the recovery of 93%? So the recovery is a number that tells us how well we've done, and it uses exactly the same formula as before. So the recovery there is 1 minus XRN. Well, in this case, N is equal to 2. So XR2 of A times that flow rate, R2, divided by X in the feed. Okay, so if you sub in those numbers, it's 1 minus 0.023 times the flow rate of R2, 85.6, and then it's 25% of 112. So the recovery there, really between the two systems, is identical, right? So we see here with these stepping off diagrams that there's a little bit of error. These numbers are not exact. If you repeat this at home, you'll probably get a number, maybe 87, you might get 83. You'll get some number that's in that range. Okay, so the recoveries, 92, 93%, are essentially the same. So no difference based on that perspective. But here's where the interesting part comes in. The solvent use in cross current is much greater, almost 4 times higher than counter current. Is that a big deal? Absolutely. Some of these solvents are in the order of $1,500 per ton. Okay. So you're paying a lot of money for those solvents. This is not a particularly expensive nor cheap solvent. So now you do get to regenerate and reuse your solvent, but you always have to top it up. Right? The solvent gets spent after a while, and so we have to keep adding in. So the operating costs there are substantial for solvent. N equals 2 versus N equals 6. Higher capital cost for the counter current. So CapEx, your capital costs greater on the counter current stage. So still not really clear which one is better. But let's take a look at this particular two entries. What's the total extract flow for the cross current system? Remember, the extract is the stream that you're really interested in. This contains your product A. What flow rate is it for the cross currents? This isn't tricky. 126. Okay, so it's the sum of 66.2 from the first stream. So E1 plus E2 is equal to 126.4 kilograms per hour. So you get a high extract flow, but at what concentration? Well, the counter current example we calculated when we just did that lever rule, I calculated the value 54 kilograms per hour for you. What concentration was E1? If you go back to your triangular diagram, I have the projector up, so I can't show you that quickly. But E1, you simply just read off the diagram. It is the concentration of A in the stream leaving out over there, which was roughly, just check your diagram. Ballpark figure. Someone at the back over there. 47, 48, okay. So 0.48. Everyone should get that quite quickly. So 48%. What's the extract concentration from the cross current system? Any rough answers? No one's awake yet, it seems. 30%? Yes, no. A little lower, yeah. 20-ish. So these two streams, E1 and E2, will be combined up together. Right? So E1, E2 get blended. So the blended concentration is what we're interested in. So if you take these two streams in your plant, you're going to collect, if you've got three stages, you're going to collect three of these streams, four stages, four of these streams, and so forth. You're going to get a total E. So TR said that was 126.4. That's your total flow. If you do a simple sum and blend calculation over there, you get the concentration of the extract for species A is 0.21. Okay, so a simple sum, linear combination of those flows and concentrations, 0.21. So now which is a better option based on this perspective? Which would you pick if you're only looking at concentrations and flows? Okay. Countercurrent seems a more attractive. You've got a slower flow rate at a much higher concentration. Remember, our flow sheets are always just sequences of separation steps. When we started the section, we said that liquid-liquid extraction essentially converts your problem from extracting A out of the feed. You've converted the problem of getting A out of this feed. Now your next problem is getting A out of the extract. So I'd rather treat a slow flow at a higher concentration than treat a large flow at low concentration. Okay? We always have that in engineering. It's far more attractive to treat lower flow rates, because that means smaller equipment costs, at higher concentrations. High concentration gradients, I can do mass transfer far more effectively. That really is why carbon capture is such a difficult problem. We can't capture carbon just out of the sky, because the concentration of carbon is extremely low, and we've got an incredibly large volume of air to treat. So carbon capture is effectively done right at the source of the carbon, as it's coming out of the smokestack, where you've got high concentrations with low flows. So we always see this in engineering. High concentrations, low flows are far more desirable, so countercurrent is the way to go for that reason. The last step, the last comparison point is based on separation factor. Okay, separation factor, let's think back to what that equation was. You probably don't have those notes with you, so I'll write it up over here. When we looked at separation factor, we looked at the separation of one species from another. So in this case, I'm going to look at the separation of A from C. Okay. And the equation for separation factor says it's XA in stream 1 over XC in stream 1 divided by XA in stream 2 versus XC in stream 2. So that's just a raw application of the separation factor formula we saw right at the start of this course. Okay, so what is stream 1 and what is stream 2? Okay. Any other suggestions? Remember what the separation factor looks like. I'm running out of board space, so I'm just going to create a small region here to work with. Remember separation factor, when we referred to it with stream ones and twos, it said if you bring in something into a unit, you're going to have two streams leaving, one and two. And that's what the subscripts one and two refer to. Okay. What's coming in this system is S plus F is coming in. You're contacting solvent plus feed. What are the two streams leaving? Extract and raffinate. Okay. So You get to pick what 1 and 2 are. Remember that formula for separation factor? You get to choose what 1 and 2 are. And if you get a value of S, AC, smaller than 1, you know that you've chosen badly. And then you just flip 1 and 2 around. Okay? So I already know what the better option is for 1 and 2. So A, XA, stream 1, I'm going to be using as the extract stream, and stream 2 I'm going to be using as the raffinate stream. So let's look at that in the countercurrent formula. That's going to correspond to X E A divided by X E C. And the denominator is going to be X R A over X RC. Okay, so I'm going to, in fact, use that formula for both. That formula holds for both countercurrent and crosscurrent. And if you sub in the values XEA, well, that's the global concentration of A in the extract is 21%. Okay, so the global concentration of A there was 0.21. We do need the concentration of carrier in the extract stream. Now, we don't have the triangular diagram off here to read off the values, so I'm just going to give it to you. You can confirm for yourself at home. So XEC was 0.045. The same way I calculated this blended concentration of A in the extract, I calculated the blended concentration of C, the carrier, in the extract. So nothing difficult there. It's just I don't have the triangular diagram to show you that calculation. And then my denominator is how much A is in the raffinate. Well, how much A was in the raffinate is given to us right here, 0.023. And how much of C is in the raffinate? This is a number I would, again, read off my triangular diagram. So remember, once we get a point on that triangular diagram, you get all three concentrations, A, C, and S. So I just read the other one off. And in that particular instance, it's 0.89. Okay. So the separation factor for cross current is, in fact, 180. Got 2-3 minutes to calculate the separation factor for the countercurrent system. Okay, so you've got the triangular diagram for the countercurrent system in front of you. Quickly calculate that number. Okay, any answers for the numerator? What's the first term? What's the concentration of A in the extract?
48%,
so 0.48. Concentration of C in the extract? 11% over there. Anyone else? Other numbers? 11, 12. Okay. So I got 0.13, but 0.11, 0.12, any number sort of in that range. The denominator, the first term, XR in the raffinate, 2.5%. That was what we had aimed for right at the beginning. Okay. And then the concentration of carrier in the raffinate. 90%? Okay, 0.9. Okay. So that gives you a separation factor of about 133. So which one is better based on the separation factor alone? That was your only consideration. Cross current, okay? So cross current gets a higher separation factor. That seems a little counterintuitive. Looks like the recoveries are around about the same. What is it? Why is that higher? Higher is better, and it's only higher because we're using so much more solvent. Okay, so there's a lot of fresh solvent coming into that cross-current system to get at that separation for you and pick away A and separate it from the carrier C. Okay? So I'm hoping that this discussion points out to you that it's not always obvious which one is going to be the better choice. It always comes back down to economics and that you don't get something for nothing. So next class, we'll be looking at adsorption, a new section. I'll be posting the notes for that later today.